and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we humbly pray that as your only begotten Son was this day presented in the temple, so we may be presented to you with pure and clean hearts by Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Lift up your heads, O gates, lift them high, O everlasting doors.
And the King of glory shall come in.
Who is this King of glory?
The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, lift them high, O everlasting doors.
And the King of glory shall come in.
Who is he, this King of glory?
The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory.
A reading from the Epistle to the Hebrews. Since, therefore, the children share flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same things, so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. For it is clear that he did not come to help angels, but the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple. And when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. Then, as a widow, to the age of 84, she never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord.
May our words be found in yours, and may your word be always found in us, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. From Luke's Gospel, guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God. I know that there are two reasons why most of us are here tonight. The first, of course, is for our dear friend John. We were going to celebrate his baptism, but instead tonight we have an opportunity to pray for him, to pray collectively that God will do for him, even as we ask. That, of course, is the first reason. The second, though, is because of Groundhog Day. That is tomorrow, and I feel like perhaps I should start with number two, since I'm saying that that's one of the reasons that we are here. I'll tell you why. The scriptures and the prayers that we are using tonight are for the Feast of the Presentation. You probably caught the story. It is the story of Jesus going to the temple for the very first time. Only a few weeks old, Mary and Joseph bring him to the temple and offer there the sacrifice to celebrate his birth. And we remember that every year, 40 days after Christmas. You see, the Feast of the Presentation always comes 40 days after Christmas. Get out your calendars and look. It has been exactly 40 days. And we remember in that story how Simeon and Anna, both very old, were there. And they saw Jesus just as a little child, and in him they saw so much of their lives finally fulfilled. Well, as the years went by, every year, 40 days after Christmas, because that is when a child would have been dedicated, Christians gathered together and celebrated this story. And as made sense in the Northern Hemisphere, they also lit candles, because winter was halfway over. And so because of that, every year when Jesus was brought to the temple, in the story of the church, candles were lit to celebrate that the darkness was finally going away. I never knew how awful it would be, having grown up in Georgia, until I moved here to Massachusetts and found how awful the darkness of winter is. And now my heart is warmed by the idea that we might always come together 40 days after Christmas and give thanks to God that the darkness is finally fading. Well, with that, a superstition grew. You know the superstition well. Halfway through the winter, people would get together and ask, how much longer is it going to last? The Feast of the Presentation, also called Candlemas, was the time where people would ask together, how much longer is winter going to last? There's an old poem about it, about Candlemas, the Feast of the Presentation. It goes like this: if Candlemas is bright and clear, there will be two winters in the year. Now you see the connection? That's where the story of the groundhog came from. After leaving on the Feast of the Presentation, they would go outside and wonder, how long is winter going to last? Punxsutawney Phil, my friends, is a Christian. He is a symbol of the faith of the church that gathers 40 days after Christmas and prays that the darkness of life will pull back, that the light of Christ will indeed enlighten the world. Punxsutawney Phil, of course, is a great metaphor. He was intended to be that way, of looking out into the darkness, but seeing through it. Knowing that darkness is not intended to last forever, we are meant to know the light of Christ and of our God. If you can follow my metaphor, I would offer to you that Simeon was the first groundhog. He was the first to see the light of Christ. And our task, I would offer to you tonight, is to do the same. You and I are always meant to be God's beloved groundhogs, and to see past the present darkness of life, to see light that shines sometimes dimly, and to hope that the light of Christ indeed will come. That you and I, even tonight, would be given to that same hope and that prayer, that you and I would stop and gauge what is truly important in life. I'll share with you one of my favorite poems or short quotes. It's from a man named Henri Frédéric Amiel. If you hang around Episcopal churches long enough, you'll hear it every once in a while. It goes like this: life is short, and we don't have much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey this way with us. So be swift to love, and make haste to be kind, and may the blessing of God always be with you. I think that he was a groundhog too, telling people, make haste to love, be swift to show kindness, speak words of love into the darkness of life. I used to use that as the blessing at the end of every Eucharist service, but I haven't used it in a few years. I'll tell you why. One day I stood up in front of the church like this, and it was full, and I said, life is short, and we don't have much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey this way with us, so be swift to make love. And from the back of the church, I heard an amen. And I thought, never again. Today, though, I'm pulling it back out and offering it to you on behalf of our friend John, on behalf of all those who in this mortal life find themselves in a little bit too much darkness, who need words of hope and of resurrection and of life, and that you and I, as God's beloved groundhogs, would be intent on doing those very things, to be swift to love, to make haste, to be kind, to see beyond our present darkness, see that the darkness is receding, like Simeon of old, to find Christ in it, and to find his peace that lives beyond the grave. Let me tell you one final story of finding light despite darkness. It's about a man named Tommy. Tommy was in his 70s back in the summer of 2012. And Tommy had been diagnosed with leukemia. The prognosis was not good, and so Tommy and I would get together, and we would pray together, and we would talk about the things that he needed to do in life in order to make sure that he had lived it well. And of course, there were things that he had not done that he wanted to do. And of course, there were people that he loved profoundly that he had never told that he loved them. And so Tommy and I, during the very hot days of the summer of 2012, worked through that list of people that he needed to tell that he loved. And he did. He went fishing every Saturday with his grandson. He took his granddaughter out on dates. He made sure to speak words of love that had remained unspoken. And then one morning, it happened. Tommy died of a heart attack. And I remember standing there with the hospice nurse who had been given to his care. And she said, "Isn't that funny? That he spent all this time preparing to die of leukemia, and then today he died of a heart attack. He could have died today without having done all of these things that he needed to do in life in order to go well." I've never forgotten that lesson. I've never forgotten how, to me, it was a story of grace. As the scriptures say, whether we live or whether we die, to find ourselves as the Lord's own possession. That is, of course, the lesson of Groundhog Day. Wherever we are, to take a step back, to find the things in life that are important, to bear witness to whatever hope in life we have found, and for you and me, of course, to share that same love with our friend John and with each other. Life is short, and we don't always have much time to gladden the hearts of those who walk this way with us. So be swift to love. Make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of God be with you always. Amen. Thank you.
This evening, of course, we had prepared a baptism. It will take place tonight. Hopefully, it will take place soon. One of the options in our Book of Common Prayer is called the renewal of baptismal vows. And so today is an opportunity for us to renew our faith, to enliven it, to offer our own prayers. We will go through what the Book of Common Prayer calls the renewal of baptismal vows. We will do that from the baptismal font, and I would encourage you to join us in that. It is printed on your hand. Let us name before God those for whom we offer our prayers. For John, for Audrey Kavowski, all those who entrusted themselves to our prayers and prayers in this church, for Jane Essence, all those who have been involved.
God the Father, your will for all people is health and salvation.
We praise you and thank you, O Lord.
the Son, you came that we might have life and might have it more abundantly.
We praise you and thank you, O Lord.
God the Holy Spirit, you make our bodies the temple of your presence.
We praise you and thank you, O Lord.
Holy Trinity, one God, in you we live and move and have our being.
We praise you and thank you, O Lord.
Lord, grant your healing grace to all those who are sick, injured, or disabled, that they may be made whole.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
Grant to all who seek your guidance, and to all who are lonely, anxious, or despondent, a knowledge of your will and awareness of your presence.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
Mend broken relationships and restore those in emotional distress to soundness of mind and serenity of spirit.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
Bless physicians, nurses, and all others who minister to the suffering, granting them wisdom and skill, sympathy and patience.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
Grant to the dying peace and a holy death, and uphold by the grace and consolation of your Holy Spirit those who are bereaved.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
Restore to wholeness whatever is broken by human sin in our lives, in our nation, and in our world.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
You are the Lord who does wonders.
You have declared your power among the peoples.
With you, O Lord, is the well of life.
And in your light we see light.
Hear us, O Lord of life.
Heal us and make us whole.
Pray tonight, O God, especially for our friend John, for his healing, for his wholeness, for peace to live in his heart. We pray for Pia, for Juliana, Marielle, Carissa, for all of his family. We pray for the doctors and the nurses who care for him, that you would enliven their minds and inspire their hearts. We pray that you would comfort and guide all of us who care for them, that you would constantly keep them in our hearts and in our minds, that in ways that we do not understand, you would persuade them of the love that lives in our hearts for them, and that they would know that they would feel that, and that our love in these days would console them. We pray above all things, O God, that your love would offer holy consolation to John. We pray that you would give him the health and the strength to come here to be baptized, to offer himself to you, and that you, in every way imaginable, would offer your own divine self back to him. We pray for strength. We pray for recovery. We pray for remission. We pray that he might grow old like Simeon and behold you as an old man, not just as a young man. We pray that in all things your will would be done, O God, that you would be with us and give us your peace. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please give one another a sign of peace. Good evening, everyone. Please be seated. I am so glad to welcome all of you tonight to Good Shepherd in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ as we come together to celebrate the Feast of the Presentation and also to pray for our dear friend, John. I also want to say a special welcome to those of you who are not Christian, who represent other faith traditions. We are so glad that you are here. We use language of Jesus and of our hope in him, but please know we unite our prayers with yours, with the prayers of all people tonight. This evening, after our service, you are very welcome to join us downstairs for what looks to be a beautiful reception. You can go down the stairs just here in the back of the church, or you can follow this way. While that is going on, we'll have a couple of things that we would invite you to do. Number one, we have a guest book so that John will have a record of your being here tonight. We're also going to have a couple of people who will be making videos of words of encouragement, perhaps, that you would like to share with John since he cannot be here. And tonight, this service is being recorded. You see we have this camera hidden right up there in the rafters. All of this will be recorded. We are Episcopalians, so we don't want you to wave or act crazy as you're coming back from the altar. But you know, if you wanted to look up at the camera and flash a smile or a wink or something like that to let John know that he is in your prayers, in your hearts, I think that would be just fine. Finally, as we move to communion, it is our practice to welcome all baptized Christians, regardless of denomination or background. If you would receive communion in your own church, you are more than welcome to receive communion here, and we hope that you will. There's information about that printed in your bulletin. Let me thank all of you who have been such a rock for the Draggetts, for Pia and their children, and I would only encourage you to continue in that act of steadfast love in the days that are to come. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night when he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey this way with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this night and always.